The Celebrated Jumpin' Frog of Calaveras County by Mark Twain. In compliance with the request of a friend of mine who wrote me from the East, I called on good-natured, garrulous old Simon Wheeler and inquired after my friend's friend, Leonidas W. Smiley, as requested to do, and I hereunto append the result. I have a lurking suspicion that Leonidas W. Smiley is a myth, that my friend never knew such a personage, and that he only conjectured that if I asked old Wheeler about him, it would remind him of his infamous Jim Smiley, and he would go to work and bore me nearly to death with some infernal reminiscence of him as long and tedious as it should be useless to me. If that was the design, it certainly succeeded. I found Simon Wheeler dozing comfortably by the barroom stove of the old dilapidated tavern in the ancient mining camp of Angels, and I noticed that he was fat and bald-headed, and had an expression of winning gentleness and simplicity upon his tranquil countenance. He roused up and gave me good day. I told him a friend of mine had commissioned me to make some inquiries about a cherished companion of his boyhood, named Leonidas W. Smiley, Reverend Leonidas W. Smiley, a young minister of the gospel, who he had heard was at one time a resident of Angel's Camp. I added that if Mr. Wheeler could tell me anything about this Reverend Leonidas W. Smiley, I would feel under many obligations to him. Simon Wheeler backed me into a corner and blockaded me there with his chair, and then sat me down and reeled off the monotonous narrative which follows this paragraph. He never smiled, he never frowned, he never changed his voice from the gentle flow and key to which he tuned the initial sentence. He never betrayed the slightest suspicion of enthusiasm. But all through the interminable narrative there ran a vein of impressive earnestness and sincerity, which showed me plainly that, so far from his imagining that there was anything ridiculous or funny about his story, he regarded it as a really important matter, and admired its two heroes as men of transcendent genius in finesse. To me, the spectacle of a man drifting serenely along through such a queer yarn without ever smiling was exquisitely absurd. As I said before, I asked him to tell me what he knew of Reverend Leonidas W. Smiley, and he replied as follows. I let him go on in his own way, and never interrupted him once.
There was a feller here once by the name of Jim Smiley, in the winter of 49, or maybe it was the spring of 50. I don't recollect exactly, somehow. Though what makes me think it was one of the others, because I remember the big flume wasn't finished when he first came to the camp. But anyway, he was the curiousest man about always betting on anything that turned up you ever see, if he could get anybody to bet on the other side. And if he couldn't, he'd change sides. Any way that suited the other man would suit him. Anyway, just so he's got a bet, he was satisfied. But still, he was lucky, uncommon lucky. He most always come out winner. He was always ready and laying for a chance. There couldn't be no solitary thing mentioned but that feller'd offer to bet on it, and take any side he please, as I was just telling you. If there was a horse race, you'd find him flush, or you'd find him busted at the end of it. If there was a dog fight, he'd bet on it. If there was a cat fight, he'd bet on it. If there was a chicken fight, he'd bet on it. Why, if there was two birds sitting on a fence, he would bet you which one would fly first. Or if there was a camp meeting, he would be there regular to bet on Parson Walker, which he judged to be the best exhorter about here. And so he was, too, and a good man. If he even seen a straddle bug start to go anywheres, he would bet you how long it would take him to get wherever he was going to, and if you took him up, He would follow that straddle bug to Mexico, but what he would find out where he was bound for and how long he was on the road. Lots of the boys here have seen that Smiley, and I can tell you about him. Why, it never made no difference to him. He would bet on anything, the dangest feller. Parson Walker's wife lay very sick once, for a good while, and it seemed as if they weren't going to save her, but one morning he come in, and Smiley asked how she was, and he said she was considerable better. Thank the Lord for his infinite mercy, coming on so smart that with the blessing of Providence she'd get well yet. And Smiley, before he thought, said, "Well, I'll risk 2.5 that she don't, anyway." This year Smiley had a mare. The boys called her the 15-minute nag, but that was only in fun, you know, because, of course, she was faster than that, and he used to win money on that horse. For all she was so slow and always had the asthma or the distemper or the consumption or something of that kind, they used to give her 200 or 300 yard start and then pass her underway, but always at the fag end of the race she'd get excited and desperate-like and come cavorting and straddling up and scattering her legs around limber, sometimes in the air, sometimes out to one side amongst the fences, and kicking up more dust and raising more racket with her coughing and sneezing and blowing her nose, and always fetch up at the stand just about a neck ahead, for as near as you could cipher down. And he had a little small bull pup that, to look at him, you'd think he wasn't worth a cent, but to sit around and look ornery, and lay for a chance to steal something. But as soon as money was up on him, he was a different dog. His underjaw began to stick out like the forecastle of a steamboat, and his teeth would uncover and shine savage like the furnaces. And a dog might tackle him, and bully rag him and bite him, and throw him over his shoulder 2 or 3 times. And Andrew Jackson, which was the name of the pup, Andrew Jackson never let on but what he was satisfied and hadn't expected nothing else. And the bets been doubled and doubled on the other side all the time, till the money was all up. And then all of a sudden he would grab that other dog just by the gind of his hind leg and freeze to it. Not chew, you understand, but only just grip and hang on till they throwed up the sponge, if it was a year. Smiley always come out winner on that pup, till he harnessed a dog once that didn't have no hind legs, 'cause they'd been sawed off by a circular saw. When the thing had gone along far enough and the money was all up, and he come to make a snatch for his pet holt, he saw in a minute how he'd been imposed on, and how the other dog had him in the door, so to speak. And he appeared surprised, and he looked sorter discouraged-like, and didn't try no more to win the fight, and so he got shucked out bad. He gave Smiley a look, as much as to say his heart was broke, and it was his fault for putting up a dog that hadn't no hind legs for him to take hold of, which was his main dependence in a fight. And then he limped off a piece and laid down and died. It was a good pup, was that Andrew Jackson, and would have made a name for himself if he'd lived, for the stuff was in him, and he had genius, I know it, because he hadn't had no opportunities to speak of, and it don't stand a reason that a dog could make such a fight as he could under them circumstances if he hadn't no talent. It always makes me feel sorry when I think of that last fight of his'n and the way it turned out. Well, this year Smiley had rat terriers and chicken cocks and tomcats and all them kind of things till you couldn't rest, and you couldn't fetch nothing for him to bet on, but he'd match you. He catched a frog one day and took him home, said he calculated to educate him, and so he never done nothing for 3 months but set in his backyard and learn that frog to jump. And you bet you he did learn him, too. He'd give him a little punch behind, and the next minute you'd see that frog whirling in the air like a donut. See him turn one somerset, or maybe a couple. if he got a good start and come down flat-footed and all right like a cat. He got him up so in the matter of catching flies and kept him in practice so constant that he'd nail a fly every time as far as he could see him. Smiley said all a frog wanted was an education, and he could do most anything, and I believe him. Why, I've seen him set Dan'l Webster down here on this floor. Dan'l Webster was the name of the frog. And sing out, "Flies, Dan'l, flies." And quicker than you could wink, he'd spring straight up and snake a fly off from the counter there, flop down on the floor again as solid as a gob of mud, and fall to scratching the side of his head with his hind foot as indifferent as if he had no idea he'd been doing any more than any frog might do. You never see a frog so modest and straightforward as he was, for all he was so gifted. And when it come to fair and square jumping on a dead level, he could get over more ground at one straddle than any animal of his breed you ever see. Jumping on a dead level was his strong suit, you understand. And when it come to that, Smiley would ante up money on him as long as he had a red. Smiley was monstrous proud of his frog, and well he might be, for fellers that had traveled and been everywheres all said he laid over any frog that ever they see. Well, Smiley kept the beast in a little lattice box, and he used to fetch him downtown sometimes and lay for bed. One day a feller, a stranger in the camp he was, come across him with his box and says, "What might it be that you got in your box?" And Smiley says, sorter indifferent like, "Might be a parrot, or it might be a canary, maybe, but it ain't. It's only just a frog." And the feller took it, looked at it careful, and turned around this way and that, and says, "So it is. Well, what's he good for?" "Well," Smiley says, easy and careless, "he's good enough for one thing, I should judge. He can outjump any frog in Calaveras County." The feller took the box again, took another long, particular look, and give it back to Smiley and says very deliberate, "Well, I don't see no p'ints about that frog that's any better than any other frog." "Maybe you don't," Smiley says. "Maybe you understand frogs, or maybe you don't understand them. Maybe you've had experience, and maybe you ain't only an amateur, as it were. Anyways, I've got my opinion, and I'll risk $40 that he can outjump any frog in Calaveras County." And the feller studied a minute, and then he says, kinder sad-like, "Well, I'm only a stranger here, and I ain't got no frog. But if I had a frog, I'd bet you." And then Smiley says, "That's all right, that's all right. If you'll hold my box a minute, I'll go and get you a frog." So the feller took the box, and put up his $40 along with Smiley's, and sat down to wait. So he sat there a good while thinking and thinking to himself. And then he got the frog out and prized his mouth open and took a teaspoon and filled him full of quail shot. Filled him pretty near up to his chin and set him on the floor. Smiley, he went to the swamp and slopped around in the mud for a long time, and finally he catched a frog and fetched him in and gave him to this feller and says, "Now if you're ready, set him alongside Dan'l with his forepaws just even with Dan'l, and I'll give the word." Then he says, "One, two, three, jump." And him and the fella touched up the frogs from behind, and the new frog hopped off, but Dan'l gave a heave, hoisted up his shoulders, so like a Frenchman. But it wasn't no use. He couldn't budge. He was planted as solid as an anvil, and he couldn't no more stir than if he was anchored out. Smiley was a good deal surprised, and he was disgusted too. But he didn't have no idea what the matter was, of course. The feller took the money and started away. When he was going out of the door, he sorter jerked his thumb over his shoulders this way at Dan'l. Says again, very deliberate, "Well, I don't see no p'ints about that frog that's any better than any other frog." Smiley, he stood scratching his head, looking down at Dan'l a long time, and at last he says, I do wonder what in the nature that frog throwed off for. I wonder if there ain't something the matter with him. He appears to look mighty baggy somehow. And he catches Dan'l by the nape of the neck and lifted him up and says, "Why, blame my cats if he don't weigh 5 pound." I turned him upside down and he belched out a double handful of shot. And then he see how it was, and he was the maddest man. He set the frog down and took out after that fella, but he never catched him. And here Simon Wheeler heard his name called from the front yard and got up to see what was wanted. And turning to me as he moved away, he said, "Just sit where you are, stranger, and rest easy. I ain't gonna be gone a second. But by your leave, I did not think that a continuation of the history of the enterprising vagabond Jim Smiley would be likely to afford me much information concerning the Reverend Leonidas W. Smiley, so I started away. At the door, I met the sociable Wheeler returning, and he buttonholed me and recommenced. "Well, this year Smiley had a yaller one-eyed cow. I didn't have no tail, only just a short stump like a banana, and..." "Oh, hang Smiley and his afflicted cow," I muttered good-naturedly, and bidding the old gentleman good day, I departed.